Hello and welcome to Tech This Week. On Wednesday, the RBI extended the timeline for the implementation of the new rules for recurring online transactions to September 30th. The earlier deadline was March 31st. In today's episode, Tech Circle speaks to BillDesk and Razorpay to understand what these new RBI rules are all about and how they impact the digital payments ecosystem. Also making news this week is Japanese conglomerate Hitachi's $9.6 billion acquisition of GlobalLogic. My colleague Vignesh Anantraj joins the show later to decode the deal. But first, let's take a look at the top headlines from this week. Amazon acquires Indian retail startup Purple. The American e-commerce giant has acquired four-year-old Purple's POS business for an undisclosed sum. Purple offers mobile payments device, which is point-of-sale machine, to offline retailers to help them accept digital payments and also establish presence on various mini app stores, including those run by Paytm, PhonePe, and Google Pay in India. As part of the acquisition, Purple's POS team will join the roles of Amazon. Next up, MobiKwik's alleged data breach affects millions of users. IPO-bound fintech startup MobiKwik was trending on Twitter all through Tuesday morning as multiple claims emerged on the microblogging platform about a purported data breach. The data breach scaled to an expose of 37 million files, KYC documents of 3.5 million individuals, and 100 million phone numbers, emails, passwords, geodata, bank accounts, and credit card data. MobiKwik said in a blog post that it is considering the seriousness of the allegations and by way of abundant caution, it will get a third party to conduct a forensic data security audit. Wipro appoints a new CTO. Homegrown IT services major Wipro has appointed Shubha Tatavarti as its new Chief Technology Officer. She is a former PayPal executive with over two decades of experience in the IT industry, spanning product development, delivery, lifecycle management, cloud computing services, data technology, and analytics. Prior to her latest role, she was a senior director of technology commercialization at Walmart. Wipro's previous CTO, K.R. Sanjeev, retired on December 31st after 32 years of service with the firm. OTT subscription revenues drove 42% to $68 million. Following the COVID-19 lockdown and the subsequent surge in digital content consumption, OTT platforms in India saw 42% increase in revenue. According to a new report published by market tracker Redseer Consulting, the revenue for subscription platforms has grown from $49 million in April 2020 to $68 million in February 2021. The surge comes as new platforms HoiChoi, Sun NXT and improved Disney Plus Hotstar launched, focusing on specific target audiences and older ones increase their footprint with more users, new original content, etc. Byju's, Unifor and HealthPlix raised big funding rounds. EdTech Decacon Byju's raised around $460 million as part of a Series F round led by MC Global EdTech Investment Holdings LP at a post-money valuation of over $13 billion. A total of nine investors participated in that round, including B Capital. Conversational AI technology company Unifor raised $140 million in a Series D funding round, which was led by Sorensen Capital Partners. Along with some returning investors, the round also saw participation from new investors from Europe and the Middle East. Bengaluru-headquartered EMR provider HealthPlix Technologies raised $13.5 million in a Series B round led by Lightspeed. The round also saw participation from returning investors JSW Ventures, Kalari and Chirate. Now moving on to the big story of the week. RBI extended the timeline for the implementation of the new rules for banks and payment system operators for recurring online transactions to September 30th yesterday. The framework for the same was issued in August 2019, applicable to cards and wallets. It then got extended to Unified Payment Interface, UPI transactions, in January last year. The regulator's decision to extend the deadline came in the wake of requests from Indian Banks Association for an extension to the previous deadline of March 31, 2021. This will enable banks to complete the migration process. The framework is being seen as a possible large-scale disruption to the digital payments ecosystem, impacting banks, credit card networks, and several other online businesses using recurring payment systems for services such as OTT streaming, utility bills, and even telecom services. Payment gateway BillDesk has developed standing instructions, which is called as SI Hub last year in association with Visa. For now, this looks like a handy ready-made alternative for banks, which they can adopt without upending their own systems. Tech Circle's Supriya Roy spoke to BillDesk's co-founder MN Srinivasu in detail about the SI Hub infrastructure.
Hi Vasu, welcome to Tech This Week.
Hi Supriya.
How's the week been so far?
Exciting. And for those who obviously in the payments industry would have watched yesterday's events with great interest as RBI unrolled a flurry of certain dozen notifications.
Absolutely. So, you know, we'll get right into it. We want to know from you the general state of readiness of the SI Hub offering at BillDesk and what does it really do for banks?
Right. So, Supriya, just to give a background to SI Hub, right? BillDesk has been a player in the recurring payments business for many years now, over 10, 15 years. And we are the largest player in the segment and we process payments across a variety of payment instruments, credit cards, debit cards, bank accounts, prepaid instruments, UPI, right? The whole gamut that is there. And we've been working with most of the large merchants in the country for many years now. Towards the end of 2019 is when RBI had come up with a guideline with respect to how certain card-based recurring payments need to get processed. Now, BillDesk, given that we're anyway in the business, we could understand the implications of what RBI's guideline was meant to achieve. Most players at that point, whether it was, I would assume whether banks or payment other payment processors, perhaps took the guideline a little lightly in terms of thought it was easy to kind of comply with. However, at BillDesk, we understood fully the complexity of what was to be to unfold over the next few months, right? The key part to the RBI guideline was essentially change the way an existing authorization authentication worked in terms of who took the responsibility for a recurring payment mandate. Historically, it's always been the merchant side, right? You as a customer go onto a merchant platform, set up a recurring payment, bank just authenticates and authorizes. What RBI's guideline, in essence, was trying to do was to place a significant part of the responsibility on an issuer bank to say that you need to have a track of all mandates issued by a customer on a card and need to give various flexibilities to customers to stop payments, to make changes, etc. Now, this is a seminal shift from the way traditionally all card payments, etc. work, and we understood how complex it could get. We also saw opportunity there to say that what would work for the industry. When you think of it, of this has a solution that has to work across banks to merchants, it's fairly easy to see why you effectively need one unified platform in between. And that's how the SI Hub was born, right? To create as one hub to which all participants could connect to from a solution requirement perspective. So that's how we started it. What does it do for the banks? Specifically, the SI Hub is positioned for the issuer banks on whom this compliance burden has been placed in terms of the RBI mandate. And this platform helps issuer banks attend to the e-mandate registration and transaction processing businesses in a manner that is compliant with the RBI requirements. So it's largely focused on the issuer bank side, helping them meet RBI guidelines and compliances. At the same time, it offers incremental functionalities to the acquiring banks and payment aggregators who form part of the larger ecosystem of payment processing.
That manner of product thinking so early in the day looks like has given a big head start to BillDesk. And with that whole argument of, you know, early bird getting the worm, could you give me some sense on how SI Hub has scaled so far? And what are the company's expectations with it? Could you give us some sense on the growth projections as well in the near future?
Right. So, as you're aware, the original deadline for banks to kind of reach compliance was 31st March. And I think over the course of the last year, because of the pandemic, from a bank side perspective, obviously the timing of getting onto the platform had complexities in terms of the internal priorities. But beyond the banks, once the banks are ready to, there is a larger play here in terms of the rest of the chain, the payment aggregators and the merchants also doing a minor tinkering at their side to be complying with what the issuer banks would need. So that's what the chain requires. From a platform perspective, today it is the one robust solution in the market. Right? It's being built based on the years of experience that we have in the domain. And we've been partnering all the large banks in India for over 20 years now. So it's been an easy choice for banks to make to kind of integrate onto this platform. Given the happy position we are in that this is an accepted platform by the banks, what we would expect is all large issuers will integrate to this platform. Given the incremental timeline, it offers an incremental breathing space to align their internal processes to confirm to this. But what we would expect is largely all the card issuers in India would get integrated in the platform, and this will become the platform of choice in the marketplace. The platform is obviously robust, and it will take on the volume that the market has to offer. Remember, recurring payment standing instant transactions are a current business of the market. There's just a new modality to it.
Yeah.
So what should happen around the cutoff date is all existing volume of the market in that business is likely to shift onto this platform to enable compliance everywhere. So, yeah, I mean, we would expect to begin with most of the market volume moving onto this. At the same time, we're cognizant of the fact this is India. There'll be me too and copy solutions that will emerge over the next few months on this, and other players will want to build similar solutions with reasonable functionalities. But ours is an open platform. It's freely available to all, and including to competitors, for them to assess and learn from it. So
yeah,
I would expect, I said initially, most of the market volume to move on to this platform.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you so much for your time, Vasu, and just sharing your thoughts as well as us.
Thank you, Supriya.
All right, next up, in a major push to its digital transformation initiatives, Japanese conglomerate Hitachi announced the acquisition of California-headquartered software development firm GlobalLogic for a consideration of $9.6 billion. The deal, which remains subject to customary conditions and regulatory approvals, is expected to close by July 2021. We now have Vignesh Anantraj joining us to talk about this in detail. Thanks, Vignesh, for joining us. And we'll start with, what does this acquisition really mean for Hitachi?
Hi, SS. So thank you for having me. So from Hitachi's perspective, this acquisition will strengthen its Lumada digital portfolio, which is a set of digital solutions focused on what Hitachi refers to as a social infrastructure. So the main sectors it will look to address are rail, energy, and healthcare. And Hitachi will see is that it's going to have more than 20,000 people from GlobalLogic who are experts in software product engineering and have experience in building software in multiple verticals. So in very short terms, it could clearly be seen as a growth engine for Hitachi's Lumada service. So Lumada is where they're trying to gather in data and trying to provide insights to their customers. It's a simple deduction, I would say, that we are moving deeper into a software-defined world. And at the center of this software lies data. So Hitachi also being more of a consumer brand, if you remember, they have a lot of home appliances, air conditioners. And Hitachi, through this acquisition, they are trying to gather more more customers in the areas of mobility, smart life, industry, energy, and IT.
Yeah. And there seems to be a lot of traditional companies who are becoming software companies now, and Hitachi seems to be the latest one in that. Also, a lot of acquisitions and mergers happening currently.
Yes, so I'll answer the second part first. So there are a large number of acquisitions and mergers happening in the space, especially between software companies. If you take Accenture, for example, they have been on an acquisition spree like anything. They have already bought 11 companies. With the rise of APIs, microservices, bandwidth, it is that much easier for companies to take the inorganic route for growth instead of building their own capabilities from the ground up. So maybe for a company like Hitachi, it might take a very long time for them to build a team like GlobalLogic from scratch and to then get the expertise in deriving these data insights. So you'll remember Hitachi as a company that made household appliances such as air conditioners, and they still do. But with this particular buy, they're trying to go into, as I said, the software route. Its CEO, Toshiaki, clearly said that the buy is what he terms as a kind of a reform for the entire company. Also know that this deal will also get the tag of the biggest buy in the space of engineering services and is also touted as the biggest by any Japanese firm.
And doesn't this buy highlight the Indian engineering talent of the world, Vignesh?
So definitely, Shweta, the Indian engineering R&D sector as a whole itself is expected to reach $42 billion by 2022. And in 2019, it was valued at $36 billion. So we can imagine what a jackpot this is for Global Logic, which got acquired for about one third of that price. And not to forget, it's also a thumbs up for and a recognition of Indian capabilities and talent in the engineering and R&D space.
All right, with that, it's a wrap on this episode of Tech This Week. Do stay tuned and logged on to techcircle.in for more interesting news and updates. Thank you so much for listening.